fast forward 2 years later, I'm now finally making this American Fool record, which has Jack and Diane. You're absolutely right. The original beat was cross-stick. It was like, doom, got goom, got doom, that. That's like a little folk song, little ditty about Jack and Diane, playing real soft. This song was not going to be on the record. Done.
Yeah, I walk in.
So I walk in because back then, the competition was to get on the radio and be on the top 10, beat number one. You're competing with Springsteen, Billy Joel, Elton John, The Police, Tom Petty, whoever's already, all these big bands, and they have the killer hook lines, the killer verses, the killer choruses, the killer bridges, the solos. They have incredible sounds. It's not the way it is today. Man, your competition was you going up other people that have incredible new ideas, because the budgets were so big, bands could spend years working on a record. Nowadays, there's no money, so you're doing it in your bedroom by yourself. I'm sorry, when you put a band in a studio, you got producers and people and songwriters, and then you make a record, and guess what? It stinks, you throw it away and start again. There was money to be able to feed the band. So anyway, I walk in one day, Criteria Studios in Miami, and it's a brutal record. John had already fired two guys in the band. John was going through a divorce. John was about to lose his record deal again. John almost died in a motorcycle accident right in front of me, going 80 miles an hour 2 weeks before we're making the record. Not in a good mood. So I walk in one day, and this Don Gaiman, the co-producer, had this metal box. I went, "Hey, Don, what's that?" He goes, "Oh, the Bee Gees are using it next door. We're going to try it on this song that we're having trouble with, you know, this Jack and Diane song with the great chorus." This is a Lin 1 drum machine. I went, "Drum machine?
Oh, my God."
They replaced drummers. Okay, I got replaced by two humans 2 years ago. Now I'm getting replaced by a machine. Now, this split second, just like when John tried to fire me, I went into a fight or flight mode, not fight or flight. There ain't no flight with me. When I'm backed in the corner, it's all fight. And I call this, and this isn't any business, adapt or die. Adapt or die. You have to be willing to make the adjustments and adapt to the situation. In this particular case, it was technology, which is in everything now. I was being replaced by a machine, no effing way. Grab the machine, grab the manual. I'm going to be a part of this new thing. So I programmed basically what I was playing, but on the drum set, but the sound was different. You know what I'm saying? It was like a machine. And it had 8 outputs so they could bring it up on the mixing board. And anyway, I hand it to them, and I'm in the lounge going like, what's going on? Is the drummer being replaced by a machine? What's my future? And I'm all perplexed. And all of a sudden, 2 hours later, I'm like, "Aronoff, get in here." That's the way John used to talk to me. "Aronoff, get in here. We need a drum solo or a drum thing after the second chorus." And I'm going, on a ballad? On radio? A drum solo? And I'm going, I'm excited because I'm on the record now as a drummer, but I'm freaking out because I got fired once, I could get fired again. So thank God we spent all day trying to get big drum sounds. Now you have to remember, this is 1981. Drums were usually in a vocal booth, small room, where they could control the sound with the mics. John wanted the biggest drum sound in the world. Put it in a big room, nobody knew exactly where to put the mics. I mean, the close mics, yes. The overhead mics, yes. But the room mics, you have to understand, there's a decay from the drum set to that next mic. Should we do 10 feet, 15 feet, 12 feet, 20 feet, 30 feet? What? High, low? What's the frequencies? The blend? We spent all day doing that, and the whole time I went, serve the song, serve the artist, serve everybody. What can I do to get my drum part and this song to explode through a car stereo speaker, explode through a TV set speaker? I had learned my lesson. Serve the song, serve the band. Crap it in my pants. It's time for me now to come up with a part. I had no part, you guys. The machine's going goosh, goosh, goosh.
Oh,
pow, goose, goose, goo. I go, pow, goose, goose, goo. Boom, blam! And I stop. I'm looking in the control room, looking for validation. I was young, so I was insecure. Am I going to get fired? And there's 9 guys in there, so I saw 18 thumbs up. And I'm like, whoo! I was thinking I still got my job. That's what I'm thinking. So I decided I'm going to go up the drums, because everybody goes down the drums. Anyway, I hit a dead end. Summoned into the control room, crapping out. My adrenaline's gone up. My cortisol level's going up. I'm freaking out. I'm going to get fired. I got half the people telling me what to play, half the people telling me what not to play. My head's spinning, and I went, dude, you're on your own. You're on your own. You've got to solve this problem. You have to solve it. I go out to the big room, and I'm looking at the drums. I felt like it was the World Series, you know? And it's like full count, loaded bases. You hit a home run, you're the hero. Strike out, you're the loser. So I'm looking at the drums. I'm walking toward the drums. I'm 40 feet from the drum. They're going, what are you going to play? 30 feet. I have no idea. 20 feet. Dude, you're going to lose your career. You're going to lose your job. You have to save the song to save your career. Save the song, save the career. Otherwise, 10 feet, 0 feet. I'm at the drums. I'm like, oh my God. I don't know what I'm going to play. And they're all looking at me. And all of a sudden, bing, the light goes off in my head. And went, all right, instead of coming up with something completely different, because I was so uptight, I had no creative ideas. I said, I'll take what I'm already doing and just manipulate it. In other words, if you had a room full of furniture, you don't like the furniture, you got 2 choices. Get rid of the furniture and come get new furniture, or rearrange what you already have. Rearrange it, and then maybe it'll be cool. That's what I did. So what I had been playing, after boom, blam, I did what I programmed on the bass drum, on the Lynn drum machine, which was now a tom-tom, started on beat 1. Boom, blam, 1, I just started it 1/8 note later. Boom, blam, 1, It was all offbeat, and everybody in the control room thought that was great. Before I could even look up, John is hitting the button to talk to me. Hit a cymbal, kikaku. I went, boom, blam, goose, 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 butaki. And then I went, Phil Collins, I'm stealing your ga-ga-ga-ga-ga-ga-ga. And I ran out of drums, so then I added this triplet thing. Ga-ga-ga-ga-ga-ga-ga, 1, 2, 3, boom. And that triplet, as simple as it may sound, they all thought that was so cool. And the long and short of it, I eventually came up with this groove that they sang, So Let It Rock, So Let It Roll. All right, I'm just excited that the song made it on the record. When the album came out, they released Hurt So Good. Back then, as you probably know, in radio, they would test. They'd play all the songs on album-oriented radio, and people would phone in and say which ones they like. Hurt So Good tested real well. They put it out, gets to number 2 on the top 100 charts. This is the, like, this is the God father of charts. When you're number 2 on the top 100, this isn't like some of these little charts where there's only 50 songs on it or something, and there's only like 2 people calling it. This is the big one. Eye of the Tiger is number 1. No way were we going to blow Eye of the Tiger out, because Rocky 1 had just come out. Right. So that was, it was in the movie. The song starts to, it was number 2 for 6 weeks. It starts to go down, and the record label does another test. Everybody likes Jack and Diane. We were like, really? All right, whatever. They release it. It eventually goes to number 1. Hurt So Good stays in the top 10. John's career completely blew up. Mine took off. We were MTV's, one of their favorite, bands. My point is, let's go back to your purpose of a drummer, is to get the song on the radio, be number 1. 2 years later, I achieved that on the biggest charts in rock and roll. And dude, some people, I've played on 300 million records sold. Some people never are on a number 1 hit song on that chart. And I did it many, many times.
I love Mind Dog. I love you. I love having the dog be the best friend of my mind.